Well, welcome back, folks. We are beginning a new set of presentations. We started last week. And again, I apologize for technical difficulties last week, but hopefully I've got it figured out this week. We are going to start talking about popular music in the 1950s and 60s. And what we're doing in the beginning is looking at the roots of that. We're going to go back, and we've been tracing the development of popular music up to the 50s and 60s, because there was about 10 stages of development of popular music. And we'll kind of review that here in a minute. So let's get going. And I don't know of any better way to open it up than listen to a little Bob Seger. Okay, well, I always start my presentations, I am this time at least, with a trivia question. And here's a really good one. What was Hank Williams' last recorded song? We all know Hank Williams, I'm sure. We know we could probably sing a ton of his songs. But most people don't realize what his last recorded song was. So I'll do a little Jeopardy music here and then let you think about it. And here's the answer. Hank Williams eerily recorded "I'll Never Get Out of This World Alive" just weeks before he died unexpectedly at the age of 30 in the backseat of his car while on the way to a concert. The song was meant to be a humorous one, but it took on a poignancy following Williams' death. Chet Atkins produced the record, and he later said that in the studio, Williams was so weak that all he could do was just sing a few lines and then fall into the chair. As far as I can find, this is the last known photograph of Hank Williams before he died. So on that note, let's kind of review a little bit. Last week, we looked at the music, how we started with popular music, and we talked about how why we needed to study it. We don't really need to study it because it's just fun, and it's kind of, kind of the soundtrack of our youth. But it's a good idea to study it because, remember, it's the music of the baby boomers. And the baby boomers are the group, the demographic group that's been in charge of this country for the most part for the last 40, and to some degree still is. If you look at the group that's leading our national government today, most of them are baby boomers. We begin tracing the development of popular or pop music with the advent of Stephen Foster, who's called the father of American music. And then we saw how in the post-Civil War period, we saw the rise of minstrel shows. And those were, in a sense, replaced by the end of the 19th century, for the most part, by vaudeville, which became a much more popular music, a little bit more socially acceptable. In the early 19th century, early 20th century, Broadway show tunes became the popular music of most urban whites. And we saw how George Cohan became the father of American music. We saw a film clip, a music clip of his from The Grand Old Flag. And we finished up talking about ragtime, created by Scott Joplin. It was a music more devoted more towards Black Americans, although it was taken in by the white population. So that's where we got to last week. So this week, we're going to continue our look at the rise of popular music. After ragtime came jazz. Now, jazz developed after World War I, primarily in the Black communities around New Orleans. And it emanated out of ragtime. But real rapidly, it spread to the large urban areas up in the north, and jazz became a really important part of the popular music scene, again, particularly amongst the Black population, but also amongst the white. It was a reflection of the rebellion view from the pre-World War I generation. And it kind of rebelled against the rules of music. If you know anything about jazz, and remember, I told you last week, I'm not a musical person other than I like it. I've been told that jazz basically breaks the rules of music. There are standardized rules of music, and that jazz kind of breaks those rules. Some of the more popular jazz musicians of the period, of course, were Louis Armstrong, saxophone. It's also notable that you begin to see much more involvement in women. Up to this point, there had not been a lot of involvement in women in music, popular music. To some degree, there was some in vaudeville, but this is when you really begin to see more and more women involved in music. Names like Ella Fitzgerald, Billie Holiday. I think we're all familiar with those names and probably remember them singing. This is Billie Holiday up here, and this is Ella Fitzgerald. And of course, that's Satchmo himself, Louis Armstrong. So I thought it'd be interesting. Let's look at a clip of Louis Armstrong as he appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show playing one of his old-time favorites, When the Saints Go Marching In. And this will probably bring back some memories to you.
Thank you.
nope, we don't want to hear that again. Well, actually, I'd like to hear it again, but that's beside the point. So, Donna, could you hear that okay? Was your music okay?
Could yes, you hear we got that pretty good. Sometimes
okay, I just want to make sure I got the music right this time. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great.
Okay, so what came next? Well, jazz was primarily an urban music. Jazz required a lot of instrumentation, required some training. Out in the rural communities, particularly in the Black communities, you had a sound of popular music developed that we know as the blues. The blues were a musical genre which originated primarily in the Deep South, again, at the end of the 19th century, and it was a very much a rural sound. It came from the Black communities, their spirituals, their work songs, what was called their field hollers, their shouts, their chants, and they were primarily composed of pretty simple rhyme narrative ballads. They weren't really big, sophisticated songs. Perhaps the best-known blues musician was a man by the name of Robert Johnson, who lived in what we call the Mississippi Delta region, stretching primarily along the Mississippi River from just south of Memphis, clear down to Louisiana in that area. Robert Johnson led a really mysterious life, and we really don't know a whole lot about him. And his life is kind of shrouded in a lot of mystery and a lot of legend. One of the most repeated legends involves him selling his soul to the devil at a crossroads near Clarksdale, Mississippi, in order to play the guitar supernaturally. There were some musicians that heard Robert Johnson when he was very young, and they said he just really wasn't very good at all. And they heard him again a couple of years later, and he was just like, where did this come from? How did you get this good this fast? And this is where that legend came. And of course, I'm sure he helped spawn it because that was good publicity. Modern musicians from Chuck Berry to Eric Clapton have acclaimed him as one of the great guitar players of all time. You'll notice, I'm going to play you a song here in a minute by Robert Johnson, and you will notice that he has a picking style. And if you know anything about Eric Clapton, Chuck Berry, you know that that's the style of music that they play. You'll also notice something. There are only two known photographs of Robert Johnson. This is one of them. You'll notice that Robert Johnson has extremely long fingers. A lot of people think that Robert Johnson perhaps had what's called Marfan disease. And that's one of the very definite symptoms of Marfan's disease is long, skinny fingers. And they feel like that's perhaps the reason that he was such a almost supernaturally good guitar player was because he could reach further than other people could reach on the frets and all. So let's listen to one of the recordings. There was actually a man from the Library of Congress went down, a man by the name of Alan Lomax, went down to the Delta during the 30s and the 40s and recorded some of these early blues players. And we have about 16 songs that was recorded by Robert Johnson playing. And again, you'll notice this is the other known photograph of Robert Johnson that we know. And you'll notice how long and thin his fingers are, much longer than most people's are. So listen to this. This is called the Crossroads Blues. Obviously, it's written about his legend as such. So let's take a listen to Robert Johnson playing the Crossroads Blues.
I'm on my knees. me. Everybody pass me by.
Okay, so that's an example of very early styles of blues music. Now, as you might imagine, the jazz and the blues did not necessarily appeal to a real wide spectrum of audiences. So another type of music began to develop in the 30s that was a little bit more aimed towards the white population. Pardon me here. I don't know why I'm playing that again. That was called swing music. Swing music began in the 1930s and was kind of a mixture of jazz and blues and show tunes. It usually came in the form of really big bands. It appealed more to the white urban populations, which was a little bit more in tune to more standardized music. You saw the rise of big bands led by people like Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller, the Dorsey Brothers. And it was the dominant American popular music for about 10 years between the 30s and mid 40s. Usually swing music featured a soloist. Sometimes it was a vocalist, sometimes it was an instrumentalist. And it was also associated with kind of up-tempo dancing, the jitterbug, the Lindy Hop. And by the way, swing music was later incorporated in the country music. If you know anything about Bob Wills and Jimmy Rogers, you know that they were two of the earliest country music players. And they, particularly Bob Wills, had something called Western Swing, which became very popular and in turn later influenced like the Bakersfield sound of country music in the 60s. This is a picture of Benny Goodman. He was one of probably the most famous of the big band leaders, although Glenn Miller and the Dorsey Brothers were probably equally as famous. I thought I'd show you a film clip. This is a group of dancers dancing to the Lindy Hop. It was a movie that was made in 1941 called Hell's a Poppin'. And this happened to be a group of dancers dancing the Lindy Hop to a big band sound. I think you begin to see the movement towards a very much up-tempo style of music that developed into rock and roll in the 50s. And you can see the beginnings of it here. By the way, these dancers, after you get done watching them, you're probably going to want to go take a nap because they make me tired just watching them. They're fantastic, but wow, they exert a lot of energy.
Hey, Pops, keep that beat a beating. I feel a rhythmic brainstorm coming on. One, two, keep that rhythm heating. One more riff like that and I'll be gone. Oh, man, don't stop now, we're jumping. Give everything to Lord now. This thing might turn into something. I ain't mistaken, here comes something now.
Hey, the show.
Put them in the next.
Okay, well, that will definitely get your blood pumping, if I can guarantee you. So, what happened next? Well, the big band era went on for some time, but as the mid-40s came along, you begin to see some of the individual soloists go out on their own. And this is when you begin to see the era of what we generally call the crooners, someone that speaks or sings softly. And they often came out of the big band era, like Frank Sinatra, Bing Crosby, Tony Bennett, Eddie Fisher, Perry Como. These were all big band singers that went out on their own and became soloists and became great recording stars, movie stars, TV stars. Of course, Tony Bennett's still alive, still out there. They sung more romantic type ballads, much smoother style than we've seen in the past. Much lower tempo for the most part. Crooning was also adopted by country music. People like Eddie Arnold, James Reeves, Ray Price, if you know anything about country music during the 50s and 60s, these singers were definitely crooners in the sense that they sung that style of music. Of course, that's a very, very young Frank Sinatra, who was probably the most famous of all the crooners for many, many years. I chose as a film clip, a movie clip, not Frank Sinatra, but Bing Crosby. And I'm not going to lie. I chose this film clip not because I think Bing Crosby is that much better than Frank Sinatra, but it also has Grace Kelly. And I can tell you what, anytime I get a chance to watch Grace Kelly, I'm going to watch it. And so here is a movie clip from High Society, a movie in 1956, with Bing Crosby crooning his way through True Love.
Suntan, windblown, honeymooners at last alone, feeling far above par. Oh, how lucky we are. While I give to you and you give to me true love, so on and on. Have a guardian angel on high with nothing to do but to give to you and to give to me love forever. For you and I have a guardian angel on high with nothing to do but to give to you and to give to me love forever true. Love forever true.
Okay, so that's Bing Crosby and a little bit of Grace Kelly singing. So what's next? Well, we are now up to the late 40s, the early 50s. Now, again, you got to remember, music was basically segregated, just like the rest of society. Blacks probably did not listen a lot to Bing Crosby and Frank Sinatra crooning. They preferred a more up-tempo type music, and that's when you see the beginnings of what's called rhythm and blues. It came out of the blues music that we saw a few minutes ago with Robert Johnson and some of the other blues musicians of the Delta region, but it had a much more up-tempo style of music. Distinctly Black, kind of a mixture of big band, gospel, jazz, blues, much more up-tempo, usually had a small ensemble band, usually consisting of a piano, guitar, bass, drums, sometimes a saxophone or other brass sections. One of the most famous of the early rhythm and blues singers was a man by the name of Big Joe Turner from Kansas City. In fact, he is often called the father of rhythm and blues. It was rhythm and blues that kind of gave rise to rock and roll. In fact, the early rock and roll singers really didn't even know what they were singing. They didn't call it rock and roll. They called it rhythm and blues. So I'm going to play you a tune here by Big Joe Turner. It's called Shake, Rattle, and Roll. And it was definitely covered a little bit later by Bill Haley in his Comets, and as well as other several rock and roll musicians of the early 50s, middle 50s. And you can see that this is why they sometimes call rhythm and blues, and particularly this one song, kind of the missing link between rock and roll and rhythm and blues, because this is kind of where you begin to see a movement towards what we call rock and roll of the 50s and 60s. So here is Big Joe Turner singing Shake, Rattle, and Roll.
Sort of slow the tempo down and introduce you to some real solid groove, music that's sound as a rock. In fact, I'd like to present to you a man who wisened the world up about what the blues is all about. They call him Big Joe Turner, the daddy of the blues, and I'd like to set a tempo sort of like this for him to bring him on so I can give him to you. Hey, Joe! Hey, Big Joe Turner! Come on in!
Crazy, no? Down though, boy. Let him rock a while. Three. Get out of that kitchen, baby. Wash your face and hands. Get out of that kitchen, baby. Wash your face and hands. Wear your big smile up because I'm such a hungry mess.
Thank you.
my D.